10 to, you know, in March. And obviously, in light of whatever is in this four-page memo, and there has been talk that his name specifically is in that memo, coupled with DOJ Inspector General Michael Horowitz's report that's soon to come out, and allegedly there may have been conversations between the Inspector General and the new FBI Director Christopher Wray, that this kind of perfect storm came together, and it seems as though that folks thought it might be best for him to go ahead and move on at this point in time. Wray had indicated that he was going to demote him, and I think it was purely within McCabe's purview to decide, I'll just go out as the number two, as opposed to going out in any other position.
But my point is this, do we have some replacements?
Well, I'm sure that they have some good quality folks, and it's not unusual for the new FBI director to put together his own executive team.
And I understand that, but my point is, why has he had somebody replace him? Okay.
Why that? He just got recently confirmed not too long ago. So I mean, I'm not sure what the thinking was.
Come on, Lloyd. Come on, you said your chief deputy. Want someone? Would you have somebody lined up to replace him?
Oh, I think he does. I think he's got a good idea of who he wants to replace him. As I said before,
well, why he hasn't announced it?
Because I think the optics were going to be bad no matter what he did. You know, it was going to be he replaced him because of what's going on, or succumbing to the pressure of the president, or this or that, or otherwise. And that was always going to be the issue and the challenge as it relates to this. I had the pleasure of actually meeting Andrew McCabe, and he's a terrorism expert with the FBI, and has been in the audience of several presentations that he made up in Washington, D.C. I will tell you that his reputation in the terrorism world is second to none, as the breadth and depth of his knowledge of the subject matter is something that he played a very important part in setting up the threat assessments and evaluating the threat assessments to this country from other countries around the world. So, you know, in that respect, very well respected by law enforcement across the country. Obviously, his role as the number two of the agency changed his purview significantly. And I think the big issue is that, and even among some checks, it seemed to imply that people thought that he should have recused himself from any investigation relative to Clinton in light of the closeness of his wife, who was running for a state Senate seat in a Democratic primary that she won without opposition and ended up losing to a Republican candidate in the general election. Having received almost $700,000 from Terry McAuliffe's PAC, as well as the Virginia Democratic Party, much of which, as we know, in those types of closed primary systems are controlled by whoever the governor is, and Terry McAuliffe was the governor then at that time, and a Democrat, that the optics were not going to be good. And I know that the president received a lot of criticism for calling them out on that. Now, hindsight is 2020, if you look back and you say, and even folks within the FBI have said that they thought that he should have recused himself. So where we are at the present time, and as pointed out by Steve Portnoy, is that the House Intelligence Committee voted to release the four-page memo. Representative Devin Nunes, the chairman of that committee, is looking to release this memo. They voted in favor of releasing it. The president now has 5 days to decide what he's going to do. If he does nothing, it will be released. If there's some changes that are going to be made in this whole process that Stephen Portnoy talked about that we might have to go through that you've never seen before, at the present time, the White House says that they're conducting a legal and intelligence review in order to determine whether to release this memo and whether or not it's going to cause and compromise if they do so, as well as looking at a legal review as well. And so that's kind of where we are at the present time. I don't think anything's going to happen today in the advent of the State of the Union address. If anything, it will probably be Wednesday where a comment is made, so not to take any attention away from the State of the Union address today, and then we see where we are. The other little interesting, twist and turn is this DOJ Inspector General Michael Horowitz report, and it's been reported by a number of news agencies that he has been in contact with Christopher Wray. There's some suspicion that that's there, and there's some reference to the fact of this report in helping stimulate this decision at this time. We want to hear what your thoughts are, whether or not you think, that this is simply just Director Wray putting together a new executive team, whether or not this has been motivated by the President's criticism of Pat McCabe or otherwise. We'll go straight to the talk lines when we return. This is Newell Norman on WWL.
CBS News update. House Speaker Paul Ryan urges a Republican memo to be released. It says to suggest surveillance improprieties by the FBI and the Russia investigation, and the GOP-led House Intelligence Committee has given it the green light.
What's up, Kate? Follow the process as the process is laid out. That's precisely what is happening. I would remind you that the Democrats tried blocking the rest of the members of Congress from even having access to the memo that the majority wrote.
And a competing Democratic memo was voted down by the committee's GOP majority. Then you have to follow a read on what happens now.
Now the president has 5 days to decide whether or not to block its release, despite the fact that the FBI and the Justice Department have objected to releasing it. Ultimately, this decision lies with the president. He alone has the power to block its release.
And it's not likely he will. In earlier tweets, he called for the memo to see the light of day. CBS News update. I'm Steve Kathan from our Ladder and Bloom studio, leading the way in Louisiana real estate for 100 years. It's WWL First News. WWL News Time 1032. I'm Chris Miller on your official weather station, WWLAMFM.com. President Donald Trump preparing for his State of the Union address tonight, expected to take credit for the soaring economy and to highlight his tax cuts. One of the president's guests during the speech, one of the leaders of the Cajun Navy, the volunteer group that rescued thousands of people stranded by floodwaters in Louisiana in 2016 and Hurricane Harvey in Texas in 2017. Mayor Mitch Landrieu today to discuss Mardi Gras public safety for the upcoming celebration.
It's Mardi Gras coverage brought to you by Sprint, your lowest price for unlimited data talk and text.
On Wall Street, the Dow down 287 points, NASDAQ down 47, oil down $1.28 and $64.24 a barrel. WWL Sports.
The battle for the title brought to you by Townsend Addiction Treatment Centers. Get the help you need today. The Eagles made it to the Super Bowl at the top seed in the NFC, but were underdogs throughout their playoff run after losing their starting quarterback. They aren't favored in Sunday's bout against the Patriots, and offensive lineman Lane Johnson says they do take it personally.
We had the belief in this all along that no matter what happens, we're going to be fine. Even in the games against Falcons in Minnesota, we knew what we were. I think it's a disrespect to the other 21 guys that are playing the game too, that this one guy game.
And a guy that's gone from the Pelicans lineup is DeMarcus Cousins, as the Birds must carry on without Boogie for the remainder of the season. Luckily, tonight's game is against the worst team in the Western Conference, that